Hello and welcome to a special episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast. Now, if you listen regularly, you'll know that this podcast is normally about the future of engineering. Today, we're going to take a dip into the past as I talk to Danny Wadewitz from Swiss engineering company AeroFEM about how they use simulation and test to get an iconic 90-year-old aircraft back into the air, or almost back into the air. Danny, so the aircraft in question is the Junkers Ju-52. Could you tell us about why that aircraft is so iconic?
Yes. Hello, Stephen. Thanks for having me. The Junkers 52 aircraft is it's one of the iconic aircrafts because in a way, just due to the sheer number of aircraft that have been built, and then also it's sort of throughout the years when it was built, it was a workhorse for the German airlines and for also many other airlines. It's also been long-lasting aircraft as well. It's been reliable, it's been robust, and apparently from what the pilots were saying, it's quite pleasant to fly, really, and that's most things. And the other thing is probably the appearance of the aircraft. It looks quite mighty with its three engines and the sheer size of it, and also it from modern perspective doesn't really look like something that is able to fly. So
which makes it an interesting engineering project, doesn't it? Because actually the aircraft industry has evolved away from lots of the features of this design. We can talk about that in a minute. If I look at Wikipedia, which we can sometimes trust, it says that it was in production between 1931 and 1952, and that 4,835 of them were built. According to Wikipedia, there's three that remain airworthy. Are any of those still flying, do you know?
Well, not in Europe anymore, as far as I'm aware. I think in South Africa, there is one that's flying last time I checked, but the last three that were flying in Switzerland have been grounded following the accident in 2018.
So, and that aircraft accident which tragically killed 20 people, I think was mainly put down to pilot error, but there were some maintenance issues with those aircraft as well, which meant that they're grounded. So 4,835 of them have been built so far. There are plans to build a 4,836th aircraft, which is what we're talking about today. Can you tell us about this project to get that aeroplane back in the sky?
The Swiss company that was operating these last three remaining flying Junkers aircraft in Europe basically suffered this tragic accident, and in the aftermath of that, the whole fleet's been grounded to what you say. I mean, eventually it's been put down to pilot error, but there were other issues that were found, basically leading to a complete grounding of the fleet. And then basically there was, as this aircraft with all its history, and it's basically there was one enthusiast who had enough money to be able to put that dream into reality, to bring that aircraft back into the air. He's been flying with the aircraft in years, and he's been quite impressed with it, and also with the sight of it, with the sound of it. And basically, one of his big dreams was to bring that aircraft back into the air. And he also been the one who founded the F-13 project that made it back into the air. And so I think for him, it was a logical step to try that.
Okay. So what's involved then in basically reconstructing a classic aircraft from scratch? I don't suppose back in the 1930s there was many CAD models you could rely on, so you must have been working for drawings. How did you get the data to start constructing the models for this aircraft?
Yeah, it was basically starting from scratch again. All that was available was an old aircraft that we could look at, the two aircraft that were left with the company, which we could use to scan and basically get digitized this data. Now, Junkers were quite advanced for their time. There were drawings of everything. They had like a system, almost like a PLM system. They were under version control and everything. It was all analog, but it was all there. But unfortunately, it got all destroyed with the bombing of the Junkers Flugzeugwerke in Second World War, and there were no drawings available whatsoever. So basically, we had to redo everything from scratch. And as you can imagine, with the sheer size and complexity of this aircraft, it would have been a nightmare to do that all by hand measurement or anything. So the idea that we had was to 3D scan the aircraft, which we essentially did twice. We did it once from the outside and we did it again from the inside. And then in different stages of disassembling the aircraft, if you like. The first step was to scan the entire aircraft as it was assembled, and then disassembling the different individual components and scanning them again, scanning them from the inside, removing the skins and scanning the truss framework on the inside of the wings and scanning the inside of the fuselage and all that sort of stuff.
That sounds like a really, really kind of detailed and time-intensive process. How long did it take? Have you got an estimate of how long it took?
Oh, thousands of hours. It was, it's been a process that you could sort of keep on doing. I mean, fortunately, as I already said, the engineering art at the time was impressive. So they used a lot of like standard profiles, standard parts in the aircraft, which you sort of scan once and digitalize them. And then you trying to basically build your structure from this catalog of standard parts that you have, like you would do today. So it's not been necessary to scan everything extensively. So you could also, you have symmetry in the aircraft, which you can make use of, and a lot of sort of basic engineering principles, which were quite advanced at the time as well, which you could take into account as well. So basically, this all goes hand in hand and reduces your laborious scanning, essentially.
So you mentioned symmetry there. These are quite old aircraft, which have seen lots of operation. I guess, are they still symmetric, or is there some signs of kind of wear and tear and bending of parts?
No, I mean, the idea is to have it symmetric after rebuild. It's definitely not been symmetric anymore. It had quite a lot of incidents and repairs and all that sort of things. A lot of material deformations that come with time, creep, if you like, and all that sort of thing. So yeah, as you said, with 80 years of age, they can't expect someone to be symmetric anymore.
And so the output of all that effort was what? Is it a 3D model, or is it a triangulated surface file? What did you use as the input to the CAE models?
Yes, the output from the scanning was a triangulated surface file, or basically just a gigantic cloud of points. The real work comes after that. It's making surfaces, creating parts from all these points. And fortunately, Siemens has quite advanced the Annex reverse engineering toolboxes, really advanced and really intuitive also. So basically, with all our engineers working on that and never done that before, they picked up on that really fast and almost perfected the work on that. So I was impressive how these points could be transformed back into surfaces, into parts, into assemblies, and essentially into the full aircraft again. So it was.
And I guess we'll talk about how you use that for simulation and for kind of working on airworthiness. But actually, that's a historical record now for the aircraft, isn't it? It's the de facto record of what that aircraft looked like and probably will exist beyond the lifespan of any of the existing aircrafts, perhaps.
Yeah, I guess you could see it like that. I mean, it's just quite an interesting view. But yeah, you're right. It's the oldest aircraft now in PLM, probably.
This episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast is brought to you by Siemens Digital Industries Software, bringing electronics, engineering, and manufacturing together to build a better digital future. If you enjoyed listening to this episode, please leave a 5-star review to help get the word out about the show. For more unique insights on all kinds of cutting-edge topics, tune in to siemens.com/simcenter-podcast.
Looking back at the history of this aircraft, and again, relying a bit on Wikipedia, it said that the development of this aircraft started in 1930. It doesn't say when, but it flew for the first time in October 1931. So it looks like it was a really, if you think about how long it takes to get a modern aircraft in the air, this was a really rapid development process. Yeah. And so they got this thing flying. And as you said, with quite advanced technology, What simulation tools did you use, and how? What sort of simulation did you use on this model?
We used the whole bandwidth of the Siemens tools that we have available. I mean, we historically used the Siemens tools because we're also a reseller for Siemens. But we started with the reverse engineering, which we did in NX. Then we put the geometry that we obtained from the reverse engineering into CFD analysis, which we did with SimCenter Star CCM Plus. And the results from the CFD analysis then went into DFE analysis, which we did with SimCenter FEMAP. And so that gave us the internal loads on every truss of the aircraft, if you want. So
were there any surprises in that process? I mean, we know that the aircraft works because it flew for a very long time. So were there any surprises when you're looking at the results from the simulations?
One of the surprises was that there was little room for optimization, really. So, I mean, with the certification requirements, we had to reduce the weight of the aircraft quite dramatically. So it's been flying with a takeoff weight of 10.5 tons. Now, the limit on CS-23, which this aircraft was supposed to be categorized as, is at 8,600 kilograms. Now, that's a huge weight reduction, and especially in the aircraft industry, that's almost like an impossible task. And now, our idea was, with modern simulation tools and everything, that you would find a lot of places for improvement if you want. But then I think sort of a mixture of both, the requirements are a lot more, the requirements are more stringent now and than they were at the time. And also the engineers at the time, they knew what they were doing. So there was really not much room for weight savings on the structural side. So I think that was probably the...
No, but and I love that. I love the fact that we're attacking this with the best tools that industry has to offer. And actually, we find out that those guys, 90 years ago, were doing a brilliant job without any of these tools as well, which goes to show you just how great engineers are. So I described this aircraft before as being iconic and legendary, but perhaps a better adjective would be groovy, because it's quite famous for being a grooved aircraft. It's made from corrugated, I think, a copper aluminium alloy, the original aircraft, but the modern aircraft is going to be built or might be built out of aluminium, isn't it? Why did they change the materials? Was that a weight saving thing, or was that just because of corrosion?
No, you mean why we changed the material for the rebuild? Or?
Yeah, for the rebuild, yeah.
You have to use what's commercially available now. And I think if you compare the chemical composition of the materials, they are quite similar. We had to choose a material that is similar in strength and similar in durability, but is commercially available, because that's in times of when we did the project, and there were problems with supply chains all over the world and also in the aircraft, especially in the aircraft industry. Now, if you were to choose an exotic material, then you would have no chance to get that through certification and make it work or build it at all. So the material that we used is far and large the same as Junkers used.
And so the corrugated kind of shape of the aeroplane's exterior, which was almost classic of the Junkers aircraft, because the F-13, which you've also worked on, also had that design. Why was it corrugated? Certainly not for aerodynamics, I would think.
No, certainly not. It's simply for stability. The Junkers F-13, that was the first full metal aircraft were built, and to sort of overcome some of the problems that you have switching from wooden material to metal material is obviously weight, and to overcome that you need to go as thin as possible. And at the time, as the design, like the modern design principles of an aircraft wing, they weren't applied at the time. It's like a framework structure, so it's not like the wings carry any of the load or something, at least not in compression with the corrugations and stuff. So you had to provide some kind of out-of-plane stiffness for the metal sheet, and that was done with the corrugation. So I think that's just plain and simple, like that.
Yeah, which is one of the reasons why it's so iconic, because you don't see many aircraft that look like that, do you? Not even historically. So so we talked a second ago about the tragic crash that ended the flight worthiness of these aircraft. But if you look back in the history of the aircraft, One of the prototypes, one of the first prototypes, also crashed, because when the aircraft was designed, it was designed as a single engine aircraft. One of the prototypes crashed and they decided to upgrade it. It was felt that it was underpowered and upgraded to a triple engined aircraft. Was there any evidence to you that did it seem like it was, you know, designed as a triple engineered aircraft? There was any evidence that maybe they just stuck two extra engines on it? Did it look very elegant? I guess is the question.
Well, that's in the eye of the individual, I believe. I think it's part of why it's such an iconic aircraft. Really mighty three radial engines on the front. It's like it's the sound and it's the sheer size of these engines. It looks like it's a very powerful aircraft. And but yeah, if you look at the pictures of the one engine ones, it's certainly, yeah, I would say less impressive.
Yes, yes. And perhaps we wouldn't be talking about it today if it was a single engine aircraft. So how Maybe. Far through the kind of airworthiness certification process did you get?
With the authorities, we didn't get very far. We got to the point where we applied for type certificate, and the concept was shown on the aero in Friedrichshafen. And shortly after that, the project was cancelled. So I think we basically did all the preparations. We had the process laid out for ourselves, and never really got to show compliance to the authorities, unfortunately.
Which is slightly disappointing, because I guess would you have flown on the aircraft if it had been flown again?
Oh yeah, definitely.
Is that something you would have risked doing? Yeah, you trusted your calculations that much.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, it's been flying before, and then with all the changes we made, it's been made safer, essentially. So, like, one of the major points was the reliability of the engines, and because you had countless of little levers in the aircraft, and you had to sort of massive console where all the levers for all three engines were placed, and which you constantly had to monitor during the flight, and the way these engines were controlled, it was very easy to make errors on that or have them not running on an optimal regime. So basically, with changing that, the reliability of the aircraft has improved dramatically. And
the intention was to build the aircraft with modern engines, or more modern engines, modern avionics as well. So it would be a lot safer,
yes,
if it ever got flying again. So this aircraft hasn't flown yet and might not fly, but a previous project worked on by AeroFEM is kind of one of the precursors to this aircraft, which is the Junkers F3, which I think is probably one of the world's first all-metal aircraft. I think it was built in 1919. So it was not very long after the Wright brothers. It's one of the first commercial airliner, almost. It carried about four passengers as well. And that actually did fly, didn't it? Because I was watching the YouTube videos of that first flight last night. AeroFEM were also involved in that work as well. And I could just imagine if I was an engineer working at that on that project, standing on the airfield on a grass runway as well. It wasn't like a nice tarmac runway. I would be absolutely scared that my calculations hadn't worked. So it's fantastic to see that this process does work, and these planes do end up in the sky eventually sometimes.
Yeah, it is fantastic to see. I mean, yeah, it's a great feeling to see them eventually fly, but it's a process that is well monitored throughout by the authorities. So there is, even if you sort of, I don't know how to put that, but yeah, it's a good process. So it's complicated, but it's well monitored throughout. And
yeah, I guess it's really effective, which is good news as well. So I guess, Danny, that you don't get paid your salary to work on kind of 90-year-old, 80-year-old aircraft all the time. So AeroFEM has been around for, I think it was 21st anniversary of the founding of the company. Yep. Last year. I think you've worked there, according to your LinkedIn profile, for about 11 years. What is your day-to-day work like? What sort of projects does AeroFEM work on day-to-day?
We're mainly doing our work in the aircraft industry, or in the aerospace industry. That's like 60%, I would say, of our daily business. We are service providers, so we basically work for TC holders. We work for other aircraft companies that require changes or repairs on aircraft, which we are allowed to do from the authorities' point of view. We have a design organization approval that we hold since 2019, and that allows us to, under our own authority do, as I said, do changes and repairs on certified aircraft, which is quite a unique feature that we have for a service provider, because that's normally something that the TC holder or just companies that have type certificates for aircraft would do. But we can provide that as a service, and that's a big part of what we do. Another field that we also work for in general mechanical engineering, where we design, like, one big customer of us designs roller coasters. So that's quite a there are quite some similarities. It's mainly a fatigue and durability analysis that we do on these. But these structures, they are sort of quite sophisticated as well, because they always trying to break records, get faster and higher and more, I don't know, drilling and then all the sort of things. And we were quite heavily involved in the development of some of those roller coasters as well, which is a huge part of our business. We do aeroelastics, and that's something where we specialize. We have Arne Wolland, who's he's more over 80 years now, 81, I think he turned, still coming to work on a regular basis. So he's still working for 20% of normal pensum, and we basically do aeroelastics, aerodynamics. And recently, 5 years ago, we have started a branch CFD, like computational fluid dynamics, which is like a logical extension to the structural analysis. And we have a big design team as well, who can design, we can analyze.
So with regards to aeroelasticity, another kind of iconic project that AeroFEM worked on, and we talked a bit before this interview, and you worked on when you were quite new to AeroFEM, is the solar impulse solar aircraft, which I think set a lot of records for being the first solar aircraft to circumnavigate the world with some quite outstanding flight times as well. Again, Wikipedia is doing quite a lot of heavy lifting today. But according to Wikipedia, it flew one stage for 117 hours or 5 days or five nights from Japan to Hawaii. So that's an incredible, kind of very unusual project as well, which kind of challenges the norms of usual engineering. And it's got big wings, it has to be very lightweight. I think it's got an engine which delivers about the same power as the Wright Brothers engine. Do you have any recollections from that project?
Yes, as we started getting involved, because we were tasked to do the aeroelastics on that aircraft. Now, you might think with an aircraft that flies that slow, the flutter would not be an issue. But with the massive wingspan of this aircraft and the very, very lightweight construction, there was still, it basically has a lot less, it's a lot less stiff than a conventional aircraft. So that even with the slow velocities or low velocities, you would have to consider the aeroelastic problems. And Arne, he quite a hard time to make that actually work. So we're quite proud of that project as well. And then from there, as it normally happens, one thing leads to another, and we got involved in more and more structural work as well. So we had quite good insight into that project as well, and we're happy to accompany the engineers their way to their flight around the world,
which I think is probably a good place to end this podcast, because we've gone from a 80-year-old aircraft to perhaps ideas for some of the aircrafts of the future as well. It's fantastic to see that you're applying SimCenter tools to almost all of these projects. And it's really interesting to see how your expertise is so recognized, that the AeroFEM is a company that ends up with all these really strange and unusual challenges in engineering. So thank you very much, Danny. You've been an excellent guest. And thank you for listening to the Engineer Innovation Podcast.
Thank you, Stephen. It's been a pleasure talking to you, and bye.
This episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast is powered by SimCenter. Turn product complexity into a competitive advantage with SimSensor solutions that empower your engineering teams to push the boundaries, solve the toughest problems, and bring innovations to market faster. Thank you.